A Day in the Life of the United States, take one.
Apollo 11, 94 hours, 21 minutes, ground elapsed time.
I'm Charles Kuralt. This is the first light breaking on the United States. Cadillac Mountain, the northeast tip of Maine. On the morning of the day man first lands on the moon. This is going to be the kind of day you want to keep a record of, describe in your diary, or write a letter about. Let's say we're talking to the people who will be alive in America in 2069. Let's say this is a letter to history. History, you'll know how the big things worked out. You'll know on what day the Vietnam War ended. You'll know whether the racial tension in this country tore us apart, or whether we ever cleaned up our air and water. We hope you're there, history. We hope we didn't blow the world apart or pollute our genes or disappear in the apocalypse. But that's not what this letter is about. What we thought we'd do today is give you a little human evidence about the place the first moon voyagers came from. What we'd like to show you, our great-grandchildren, are some of the small things that usually go unrecorded. The sound of our accents, the look of our faces, how we were with one another on the day man first landed on the moon. First light on this country, 200 million strong and weak. July 20th, 1969.
This is Apollo Control following
the... This is a CBS News special, sponsored by New Dash with concentrated enzymes gets the best from the big washer, and Geritol, the high-potency tonic that builds iron in your blood fast.
I'm Sid Cherise. Now, I'm not going to tell you my age because I don't look it. You know, the best way not to look your age is to do something about it. I do. I take good care of myself. I exercise, I try and eat the right foods, get plenty of rest, and to be sure that I get enough iron and vitamins, I take a Geritol tablet every day. Geritol, I think it's one of the nicest things a girl can do for herself.
You heard what she said.
Geritol, every day.
11:10 p.m., can't sleep. 11:30, wide awake. 11:45, still awake. When you take more than 15 minutes to fall asleep and feel you need help, take Somonex as directed for 100% safe sleep. Somonex is the only leading sleep aid with three medical ingredients to quickly relax you and help you get to sleep. When you take more than 15 minutes to fall asleep, take Somonex and sleep, sleep, sleep.
The descent orbit insertion burn is now scheduled at 101 hours, 36 minutes, 13.5 seconds.
Here again is Charles Kuralt.
It's 5:25 in the morning here in almost the easternmost part of the United States. What I'm going to try to do is get to almost the westernmost part of America by nightfall. I'll see you next in Hawaii. Some 16 hours will pass. The ancient Athenians used to define a city-state as the distance you could travel from sunup to sunset. That's the size of America today. By air, you can get across the country during daylight. But that's technology. That's not the mystery of America. The mystery is still size and diversity.
We have 43 cameras standing by for this broadcast. It's just past midnight in Hawaii. Our moon and Jupiter and its 12 moons are up over Diamond Head. There's been a light rain on some Pacific highways, but out west, they're predicting fair weather for the rest of the day. Las Vegas at exactly the same moment. The temples of temptation were giving 6-5 on a successful moon landing and 5-3 on a successful return. We'll stop back here to watch a wedding you can pay for on a credit card. This was sunrise in Birney, Montana. Sunrise never got into the financial canyons of New York. The sun has to be a sure thing before Wall Street gets it. At just this moment, 5:25 Eastern Daylight Time, the four-year life of Anna Arias was in question. We'll come back here, too. In a couple of hours, the old, big, and good money in America will be ringing for breakfast. It's 5:25 a.m. in Newport, Rhode Island, where they call these castles cottages. This is what we learned from Europe. And this is what we taught ourselves, the mass production of summer shacks at Ocean Beach, New Jersey, where, other than the moonshot, the only news will be that it rained all day. Family life is the most common thing Americans did on July 20th, 1969. On the day man landed on the moon, family life began for the Barnett boy.
Here's your son, Mr. Barnett.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Best of luck.
Family comes right after yourself and before country. It is the cement that holds the United States together, that inexpressible interweave of love and discipline. Mother and child, the binary stars of life. Sunday is a day for grandfather and grandchildren. And yet, peculiarly, in this free and open society, we could not catch what most Americans were doing most. You can't tell the story of the American family because you can't take a picture of the long years and deep emotions that make a family. Only some fragments got through.
Stevie, you're getting your sleeves right into your... Oh, here. Wipe your hands up.
Grab one.
Between Stevie getting his syrup on his sleeves and Ray in her hair, it's gorgeous.
Good Lord Jesus, we thank you for this food we're about to receive, for nursing our body, for Christ's sakes, amen.
That great wall of protection that is parent, that great experimenter that is child, one testing, the other giving.
Okay,
we're going to
put one more. That was a pretty small pinch.
You're the carrier.
Ah,
a little clavour.
I thought you were a little carrier.
Hey, I told you, no making fun of your father.
This is what we were all about on July 20th, each holding on, until the time comes to give the other away.
Hey, I like that haircut. Do you want to kiss me goodbye? Have a good time, and be careful, huh? All right? Be careful, huh?
Goodbye.
Be careful, huh? Take it easy, Dave.
On July 20th, 70% of us were living on 1% of the land. That single statistical fact had not penetrated into our national poetry. Our basic legend about ourselves had to do with the 19th century, when the country was wide open, and when our fight was not to tame ourselves, but to tame nature. There were still places in America where men earned their daily bread by conquering nature. On July 20th, Apollo 11 in the heavens, and also on July 20th, a small town in Montana, Birney, population 14, not long after sunup. The horse is a three-year-old mare, Mona. The man is Bill McKinney. The horse is only halter broken. McKinney's job is to break her to a saddle and ride her.
Here. Oh, mare.
He talks to her, not particularly out of affection, but just to let her know where he is. What he must do is tie down the left rear leg, at least at the beginning. Otherwise, she will hurt herself and him.
Come on.
It's not always done as gently as this. Some cowboys break horses with lead pipes. Mona is being trained as a saddle horse, but McKinney trains quarter horses, hunters, and jumpers all the same way.
This is Apollo Control. Some 9 minutes, 27 seconds remaining until loss of signal on this 10th revolution in order orbit.
Come on. And
crew preparing now that they've finished breakfast. A lot of their other items out of the way, such as their crew checklist, sleep status, and so on.
The moment the rope attached to the tire is pulled, the mare will feel a pressure she has never known before. About an hour after he began, McKinney had a saddle and bridle on Mona. Now he was about to mount her. On July 20th, 1969, a man in Birney, Montana, rode a horse which had never been ridden before. Travis Air Force Base, San Francisco, a few hours later.
Uncle Clint.
Some of our young men were coming back from the war. Not all were able to walk off the plane. They had left Da Nang and Yokota on July 20th, and a day later, when they arrived, they were part of the 250,000 wounded who had returned from Vietnam, approximately as many wounded as the Union suffered in the Civil War. In the Civil War, the ratio had been 2 men wounded for each man dead. In the Korean War, 3 wounded for each man dead. In Vietnam, 8 wounded for each man dead. Medicine had become better. But we had had a lot of practice in Southeast Asia. Even before July 1969, Vietnam had become the longest war in American history. There were now too many wounded to think about. The best we could do was a kind of institutionalized compassion. They were handled with gentleness, but on a production line.
Put the light on, will you?
In late July, the machine of history was not Apollo 11, but the Vietnam War.
Eagle's weight, somewhat lighter than when it started out.
Ready? Do it.
Some 39 minutes, 20 seconds away from acquisition of Columbia.
Give me attention for a couple of minutes, please. I believe we can answer some questions for all of you. These remarks are primarily directed toward those of you returning from a live fire area in casualty status. Comments pertain to all services, gentlemen. Now, when you left the live fire area, most of you left all or at least a part of your personal gear behind. Submit a claim for all items of personal property which are lost. Please bear in mind, gentlemen, the only way old Uncle Sam can repay you for your personal property which has been lost is for you to submit a claim to the government for reimbursement. Are there any questions on this, gentlemen? Now, those of you who are combat casualties withdrawing flight pay, jump pay, combat pay, demolition pay, incentive pay of any kind, gentlemen, this pay will continue for 90 days from the day you were wounded. Now, the tax exemption that you all enjoyed in the live fire area, gentlemen, will continue for so long as you remain in the hospital. So when you start to make out these stateside income taxes, be mighty certain that you take full advantage of all the exemptions you're entitled to. Exemptions are mighty hard to come by in the States, gentlemen, so use what you brought with you. Any questions on this? Now, of course, the $64 question to everybody is, what's the score on convalescent leave? Gentlemen, convalescent leave is part of your hospital treatment. It's the one part you don't want to miss. This is a free ride, not chargeable to you in any way. So as soon as you can convince the doctors and the nurses at the station you're going to that you're healthy, you're full of fun and games, you can take care of yourself, you have no problems, you'll be no problem to your dependents, you need no further treatment at this particular time. And last but not least, gentlemen, you have to actually convince this doctor that you can stand the wear and tear of 30 days on the economy. Any questions on convalescent leave? Now, we mentioned these hospitals could be most anywhere. There is a compensation for this in which old Uncle Sam is going to pay your way from the hospital he sends you to your home and back on any convalescent leave that you can talk your doctor into. Now, are there any questions, gentlemen, on anything we've covered?
Eagle, Houston, it appeared to us when you're doing the P-52 maneuvering, the S-band, high gain...
A double somersault and a half twist. Death was defied at 2:47 Eastern time, to the complete boredom of the Las Vegas crowd, who didn't even look up. At 2:47 in the afternoon, the money was moving too fast. In Las Vegas, as well as all over America, we were in the midst of a cost-push inflation which nobody really understood. At 2:47 in the afternoon, they were burning money at the Bureau of Engraving, as they usually do, 6 days a week. However, at 2:47 in the afternoon, they were also printing money, as they always do, 7 days a week. Burn money 6 days, print money seven. Inflation.
All right, that's the pipe. Thank you.
At 2:47 in the afternoon, Mr. Pease Ellington had decided to spend the rest of his day watching Walter Cronkite. This is what people were doing all over America at precisely 2:47 in the afternoon. Atlanta, Georgia. The same moment in Alaska. Kentucky. Vero Beach, Florida. Newport Beach, California. Deerfield, Illinois. Rock Tavern, New York. Los Angeles. Taos, New Mexico. Interlochen, Michigan. New Jersey. Gainesville, Alabama. The Lower East Side of Manhattan. Bar Harbor, Maine. Newport, Rhode Island. Southside, Chicago. It is 2:47 in the afternoon, and Johnny Thomas has decided to join some friends in town to listen to the reports coming in from outer space.
Columbia, Eagle, Houston, 3 minutes, LOS, both looking good, going over the hill.
Columbia, right.
Eagle, right.
I want my old machine back, Mr. Purdy.
But
this new big washer does bigger loads, but no better.
Your wash is now 50% bigger. More clothes, more dirt. For big machines, you need new Enzyme Dash, a detergent concentrate. Dash puts more detergent in its detergent. It's nearly twice as concentrated. Let's try it with Dash.
Now that's what I call clean.
New Enzyme Dash. Dash gets the best from the big machine.
We did it!
How'd you do it, Rosie?
We switched to Crest.
We tried more toothpaste, but Crest with that fluoride, it worked. The others didn't have it.
That's what a toothpaste should do, Rosie. Fight cavities.
Fighting cavities is the whole idea behind Crest.
What will America's best-fed cats be wearing this year? Coats made of 98% protein. Cats need lots of protein for coats like these. Give your cat a beautiful new coat, Sir Purina Cat Chow, with more protein than any other cat food. Purina Cat Chow, highest protein cat food.
It won't matter to me if the sun don't shine today.
Yeah.
I keep bumbling along in my same old sleepy way.
America, you need Rice Checks when you're feeling sleepy. Not Wheat Checks. Not Corn Checks. They're for something else altogether. But Rice Checks is a little light charge that doesn't leave a lump in your stomach. Rice Checks. Now there's hope for the sleepy.
In all of these maneuvers, Mike Collins aboard Columbia is spring-loaded to do what is called a mirror image maneuver.
On the day man landed on the moon, our 43 cameras recorded only 100 hours of American life, and Americans gave up some 5 billion hours of their lives this day. All we caught were some fragments of conversations spoken all over the country on the day man first landed on the moon. If you listen closely, you'll hear some of the short stories that make up the American novel of our lives.
Hey, we talk languages here. Hey, todo barato. Bueno barato. Hey, tzatzke de mamas, we got it here for you. Hey, I got it on sale here. Hey, step in here, let's look them over here. Hey, help me keep my wife in the country.
I don't know the scientific name for it, but it's one of the finest trees we have. And around here, the natives call it the paper tree. And it's very dense. And no matter how high the temperature, even at 100, there's always a cool breeze under this tree. The only trouble we have is finding the time to sit under the tree and talk. And even in a shower of rain, it'll shelter you for a very heavy rain.
Now, the moon's romantic.
No. On the moon.
So you got to have some suspense going for you when you get there. You know, you just can't have them get there, and then it's a big, no, it's a big nothing. You don't know. They get there, they've got to get there just in time for something.
Yeah, and then
somebody.
They spend 2 hours there. What do they do for 2 hours?
Study their lines if they're working for me.
Jim, this is a mint julep. You ought to have one of them.
This?
Want one?
Is a Tom Collins. It's better.
Well, leaving cost is going up, you know, pretty high. But your wages is going up, too.
I made a switch from the engineering phase of the business to marketing because I felt that I could do a better job for the company and for myself. I really wasn't motivated by the engineering work, and I'm extremely happy in the work I'm doing now.
Yeah, this whole Mississippi gets pretty wild yet, don't it?
Oh, yes, it does.
I know it looked like it was up this morning yet when I come across.
Well, they got the dike. They built a dike this year, and they're going to leave it there.
Well, they save a lot of money. They should have done that years ago. They have high water every year now, pretty near.
Well, in 65, I lived in South Clinton, and we had it 36 inches over a floor.
Over your floor?
Yeah.
Didn't take you long to move, did it?
I waited in three times to move the furniture up off of the floor.
Yeah, but I mean you moved out of the house right quick afterward, didn't you?
Give it back to the finance company.
Money, as far as the yearly income, doesn't make a bit of difference as far as happiness is concerned.
The heck it doesn't. You've got to have enough to live on, to pay your bills, and send your children to school, Bill. And if you don't have that amount of money, and you can't do it...
This is real, real bud.
All you do is this.
I wish I could put it in my mouth.
You're getting mud all over me.
Kaylin!
What?
Do you fear dying?
No.
Talk to me about it.
Well, I'm not in a hurry about it. And all like that, but I'm thoroughly conscious of the fact that it's coming someday. So, why fight it? On the other hand, we've got something to look for. Over on the other side, we have had a wonderful life. God's been good to us. So we've got plenty to live for yet, but plenty to look forward to.
Friend, observe passing one. Pick them up. Bury, 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 cut. One into every pocket. Bury, turn, two, three, and again. Spring to front.
Chief OK, Sarge, we'll be placing you on 32 days special leave. When this leave terminates, you'll be reporting to Fort Dix, New Jersey for onward transportation back to Vietnam. Step down this very encounter, they'll cut your free ticket and travel home, and then you'll report back into Fort Dix 32 days from today. Do you have one of these? Do you have one of these yellow ones with you right now?
225.
Give that one to me. Okay. Once you've gone down here and gotten your tickets, you'll board the red and white bus in the right-hand corner of the parking lot.
Continue to stand by on the air ground circuit for the remaining 8 minutes of this revolution, or until loss of signal. Ground elapsed time now is 95 hours, 25 minutes.
They can't see us yet.
July 20th, 1969 was the first day in the American life of the Budasan family. When Milan Budasan touches American soil, he is the latest of some 35 million immigrants who have entered Atlantic ports. The family of 11 comes from Romania by way of Yugoslavia. Milan Budasan spent 5 years in a communist prison because of his religious beliefs and his refusal to serve in the military. His children were denied education for the same period of time. At immigration, there was a small mix-up, 11 Budasans and only 10 visas. It was discovered that Marina Budasan was born after the visas were issued, and that meant another form had to be filled out. But a few moments later, there were 11 new first-generation Americans. The rest of the day, in Milan Budasan's words.
Eu când am ajuns cu avionul aici în New York cu familia mea,
I was met by my sister and brother-in-law and their family. I remember thinking, a new life begins today. We have left an old life behind. I was tired. I was happy. Later, when I realized that this was the day man first landed on the moon, I was ashamed that I had paid no attention to so important an event.
They should be very shortly now, just about over their landing site, too. They came around at 1:47.
I am too old to understand the English perfectly, but I understood this country right away. I spent 5 years in a Yugoslavian jail because I would not bear arms, because Jesus said, love thy neighbor as thyself. And in this way, my children will be free to do everything they couldn't do in their old country, go to school, believe in God. And in this way, we looked from the car and saw New York. We were stunned by this large city with its tall houses. We have never seen this in our lives. We saw many roads and many cars. I hope that one day we will be able to buy such cars too. 4 months and months we had waited and talked of this. Yet the oldest children said very little. The youngest slept. Then we arrived at my sister-in-law's home. They have been here for only 5 years, but what wonderful things they already have. And in this way, we were reunited and we did not feel so strange. There was much to thank God for, and I prayed for the men going to the moon too.
Four hours after landing on American soil, the Badassan children were indistinguishable from the rest of the kids in the neighborhood. Immersed in America, a 35 million time story had begun again.
They must work to learn English. Then they will be as American as you are.
We've been here since Jamestown, but we haven't cleared customs yet. 400 years of traveling, and it's been economy class all the way.
We got a little thing down here called more power to the black people. But
some of my brothers live in another culture, talk another language, and you gotta subtitle them like you'd translate the astronauts.
I feel this way. We're not trying to put all the older people in the bag, dig. We're trying to dig, bring out, you know what I mean, half the community together, another half not, you dig. We're not trying to put everybody in the bag, dig. Ain't nothing wrong with the older people, dig, because we, some reason, dig, have to get older, dig, you understand? The younger people coming up over us, you dig. Some got some on the ball, you dig. You know what I mean? Some are late, you dig. We trying to keep up to date, you dig. Ain't nothing wrong with that.
My name is George Foster. I'm black, and I produce these pictures. I can tell you this about July 20th, 1969, at 43rd and Langley in Chicago, Illinois. I can tell you that nobody there understood or even listened to the language of the moonshot. That man on the right with the rolled-up Chicago Sun-Times, with the headlines about Apollo 11, he told me he bought that paper to look at the want ads. Apollo 11, shoot, that's what he told me. What was really going on in the streets of Chicago is that that black revolution that affronted whites for 3 years, that black revolution lay shattered in the streets. I mean, there are little bits of Karl Marx lying here and little bits of Malcolm X lying there. But on early Sunday morning, the insurrection was being put down by alcohol. Let me locate where you are. You're aiming at the southeast corner of 43rd and Langley, where the words aren't important. You're in the ghetto's ghetto, the slum slum. You're at the bottom of the heart of America, as Chicagoans like to call their city. Now, if words worked, nobody in this bar would need sweet red wine at 40 cents a half pint. The words don't work, but you put them up there anyway. That's Chicago. Not far from here, Dreiser wrote about the corruption. Not far from here, Lincoln Steffens wrote about the shame of the city. Not far from here, James Farrell wrote about his Irish. Meyer Levin about his Jews, Richard Wright about his blacks. But Chicago's never been moved by words. It just moves the writers right out of town. tell me how you'd reach these people, these half-educated hustlers, hiding behind hallelujahs and cheap wine. Tell me if you don't feel some beauty here, something noble in this nigger bar. The words don't work with these black brothers. They've heard too many, used too many. In the morning, this is a place of fragments. Shattered sunlight, broken promises, busted hopes. Because the roofs are on and the walls are standing, you can't see the tumble-down families, the junk heaps of wasted lives. Down there, in the debris, are two strange walls. Like everything else in the neighborhood, they ought to be defaced. But they gleam, they shine, they're sacred. One wall, the older one, is the wall of respect. Black heroes in colors as bright as stained glass. Orchestra leaders, poets, philosophers. A couple of years ago, the black community began to think in proper names and proper nouns. In 1969, they took Martin Luther King off the wall, the way the Romans would remove a useless god from the Pantheon. The man whose spirit built it is Bill Walker. He used to be a modern artist. He played the money game with the galleries and the abstract art. But he gave it all up to paint this wall with his friends.
Let the rest of the world know that we are part of the human family. And this is what the wall attempts to show, that we are somebody. This is why I had hoped that more black artists would involve themselves with the wall. I'd hoped that the actors, actresses, playwrights, poets would make the street corners their stage, make the walls their books, make the walls their canvases.
The kids at 43rd and Langley can't believe Bill Walker's doing it for nothing. Everybody's got his hustle, they say. When I said Walker never made a nickel from the wall, he did it to do good. A 14-year-old told me, doing good's a hustle too, ain't it?
Ten centuries ago, when from 2,000 miles away, Tahitian natives arrived in Hawaii, they signaled a safe landfall by a blast on a conch shell. On July 20th, against the facade of a $50 million hotel, cocktails are announced. Then there were the more familiar sounds that we listened to with pleasure on that date.
Although the wheat fields and the clotheslines and the junkyards and the highways come between us, and some other woman crying to her mother 'cause she turned and I was gone.
Taking all the money that I ain't
made. We'll rock our line as the mighty good road. We'll rock our line as the road to the
world. We'll rock our line as the mighty good road. If you want to ride, you gotta ride it like it's money. Get your ticket out of the business, gotta rock our line. Pull
out now. On a Sunday afternoon in July, there were thousands of empty side streets as hundreds of small town parades came down Main Street. Park Rapids, Minnesota had its annual logging contest. A visiting New Zealander shaved his forearm with an axe and then won the Paul Bunyan Standing Block Chop Contest in 34 whacks.
Beautiful,
Kazan.
I get a warm romantic motion when you use aqua velvet lotion. That's how our romance began. Because there's something about an aqua velvet man.
Men, put it on. Aqua velva with humectant. It's so good for your face. And oh, that manly fragrance. Aqua velva. Put it on.
What's that buzzing? An electric razor?
In a barber shop?
Sure, I get a barber close shave with my electric razor when I use Williams Electric Shave.
Electric Shave evaporates perspiration,
makes whiskers stand up, gives a non-irritating shave.
Caught ya! Feels barber close with an electric razor.
When you use Williams Electric Shave.
For a shave that feels barber close, use
Electric Shave!
Regular or cooling frost lime.
July 20th, 1969. Let's begin the day again. It is before dawn all over America. Night stretches through 5,000 miles of United States black. Except for a punctuation mark here or there, the country's asleep. The crew of Apollo 11 is supposed to be asleep. Only one city is fully financially awake, Las Vegas. It pulses brash against the desert night. Some say these signs are a new American art form, vulgar as jazz was in its beginnings, but as free-flowing. Art or vulgarity, some of these signs cost upwards of $500,000, about the price of a great Rembrandt drawing. The machines that keep these signs alive are only technically the electrical generators. What truly keeps them flashing is the slot machine. Though there are more exotic games in Las Vegas, the slot machine is the house's biggest moneymaker. The slots aren't rigged. There isn't any need to rig them. The cleverness of American industrial design makes it certain that they will keep 15% of what goes into them in the long run. The three-wheeled machines have 8,000 possible combinations, but for each 8,000 nickels dropped, only about 6,800 come back. Slot machines are the easiest, losingest game in town. The machine may now and then give up a jackpot, but the whole idea is that if you stay there long enough, if you take risks long enough, you have to lose. And that's not how the West was won.
Whose idea was it to come down here?
For somebody else's, not mine.
And I said that I couldn't watch Steve play because he's over at the baccarat tables and he's playing with $100 bills. So he said, here, honey, here's some nickels. Go have fun.
It is 5 o'clock in the Nevada morning, and at the Chapel of the Bells, 15 wedding ceremonies have been performed since midnight. Under Nevada law, you don't need a blood test, and you don't have to wait for a license, so quick weddings are a modest but thriving business. All you need is to be single, determined, and to have some sort of credit card. At the Chapel of the Bells, the night shift minister is getting ready for the 16th wedding in 5 hours. Despite repetition, Reverend Peters maintains his earnestness. This is one of your $51 weddings, including $10 for the pictures, $20 for the chapel, $5 for the minister, and $3 for the paperwork. Music is provided by tape recorder. Somehow or other, we got the 16th and 17th weddings mixed up.
Richard and Terry?
I'm sure that both of you are aware that marriage is the oldest rite and the oldest ceremony of mankind. It all started because the God who made us knew us well enough to know it wasn't going to be good for a man and woman to live alone.
Richard and Mary?
I'm sure both of you are aware that marriage is the oldest rite and the oldest ceremony of mankind. It all started due to the fact that the one who made us knew us well enough to know it wasn't going to be good for a man and woman to live alone. Richard, as you take the ring,
Richard,
place it on Mary's
place
finger,
the ring on Terry's
look
finger,
at her,
and
look at her.
After me, repeat after me.
I, Richard, take thee, Terry. I, Richard, take thee, Mary.
I, Richard, take thee, Mary.
I, Richard, take thee, Terry.
I, Terry, take thee, Richard.
I, Mary, take thee, Richard.
To be my wedded husband.
And I do promise before God.
To be thy loving and faithful husband.
To be thy loving and faithful wife.
To be thy loving and faithful husband.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and health.
In plenty and in want.
In sickness and in health.
And I do promise before God.
In plenty and in want.
Joy and sorrow.
To be my wedded wife.
So long as we live.
Congratulations and kiss your wife. Congratulations and kiss your wife.
It takes 30 seconds for the tape recorder to reverse itself. At 7:22 in the morning, the 18th wedding of the day began. Speaking of sweet, white things, the mass production of cheesecakes is underway a number of hours after Richard and Terry and Richard and Mary are married. You are looking at mass production marching towards mass consumption. These are totally automated, computer-controlled cheesecakes, untouched by human hands. In midsummer 1969, America was slowly and inevitably approaching a gross national product of $1 trillion. In earlier days, a machine-made cheesecake would be, by definition, an inferior product. But these cheesecakes taste better than most homemade and most bakery-made. It was embarrassing that something made so mechanically could taste so good. So the public relations office of this factory asked us to tell you that the cheesecakes were manufactured with loving care. What is bothering us, and has been bothering us for 70 years, are two apparent laws of machines. The first law is, at some given point, instead of the machine working for man, man works for the machine. The second universal law of machines is, whatever else a machine makes, it makes garbage. On July 20th, we were up to our waists in last year's gross national product. Then there were those who rejected the whole mass-produced mess. Midday, July 20th, 1969, Rock Tavern, New York. Ron Burke, potter, getting the air bubbles out of his clay. This stretches back before written history. Earth and water, fire and human hands. It is all in the good hands and in the good earth. Out of a pile of real dirt, touched by real fingers, comes truth. Truth shaped by human pressures into beauty. An Italian visitor once said, if the continent of Europe were to sink beneath the waves, not one human art, not one human skill would be lost. Everything that is old and good in the old country lives and thrives in the United States. Back to ancient Greece, back to Caesar's Rome, out to China, out to India, all distance and time, back to prehistoric man, the potter's tradition.
This is Apollo Control at 98 hours, 16 minutes. We are now less than 2 minutes from reacquiring the spacecraft in its 12th revolution of the moon. At this time, Armstrong and Aldrin should be completing pressure checks on their spacesuits. Coming up in this revolution.
And when the bowl is finished, Ron Burke looks at it and does to it what no machine can do to its work. This is what most middle-class American families did Sunday morning, July 20th. We leave it to future historians to discover what was profound about our ordinary lives. The only thing we note is that the seven Betke children did nothing to help their mother. They're just there, absorbing attention, love, and they're part of the 635 billion, 365 million calories our researchers say we Americans ate on this date. Most American households were commanded by three generals: General Electric, General Motors, and General Foods. But man does not live by fried bread alone. All the time the kids were eating, Mr. Betke had on his mind this technological problem: how to fit nine people and nine bicycles into one station wagon. This kind of scientific pragmatism lay behind, way behind, Apollo 11. Here comes the nine-man flight crew, all suited up. The next to smallest member was put in the command module, where she didn't fit, back to the third stage, back to the command module. It is 4 hours and 13 minutes before touchdown on the moon, and this is US 30 cutting through Iowa. It is 4 hours and 13 minutes before touchdown, Michigan. Simultaneously, the folk festival at Newport, Rhode Island. Four hours and 13 minutes before touchdown at a commune in New Mexico.
Don't break it, you give me it.
Coincidentally, a four-year-old has her first meeting with a four-pound lobster. And a doctor finishes a house call in Virginia.
Any other problems?
No, unless arthritis on this with another feet.
Four hours, 13 minutes before touchdown. A day in the life of the United States.
What did you think of that last note, Andy?
This broadcast will continue.
That's John's boss. He's coming to dinner tonight. Did you ever have to hide from someone so he wouldn't see your dirty hair? That's what I used to do until I discovered Liquid Prel. Liquid Prel gets rid of the dirt, gets my hair the cleanest possible clean.
Bev, we're home.
Bev, I haven't seen you in ages. You look fabulous.
Thank you.
Liquid Prel, extra rich in the ingredients that clean hair best.
No, no, no. I don't use soap. And I bet I'm cleaner than you. I mean, why not use something that makes you feel cleaner? Deodorant Zest. It's not a soap. It's different. Look, Zest makes twice the deodorant lather. Zest lather is packed with active deodorants. And soap leaves a soap film that sticks to you, not Zest.
That's why Zest leaves you feeling cleaner than soap.
Yes.
A Day in the Life of the United States. This portion has been sponsored by Zest, the deodorant bar that leaves you feeling cleaner, and Aquavelva aftershave lotion, famous ice blue, cool frost lime, and wild redwood. Newport, Rhode Island, July 20th, 1969. Later in the day, the Newport Folk Festival will take place here. Sleeping anywhere the city officials will permit are the young. Many of these people say they've turned away from traditional values, yet they are here to listen to 19th century style music. Those who most question American values are in Newport to hear American folk songs. So begins a profound paradox. The other side of the paradox shows itself at a summer camp at Interlaken, Michigan, a few hours later. In Michigan, the clean-cut, short-haired, well-dressed American youths are deep in a study of 19th century European music. To discourage sexuality, the Interlaken officials have dressed the girls in knickers. There is a clue here to something deep in the American experience. In the Michigan woods, Lisa Bernstein, age 9, struggles with the Grieg Concerto, written at the end of the 19th century. Unseen behind her are all the cultural forces of 70 years ago, Chopin, Liszt, Paderewski. This is a primal force that lies behind us all, the land, from whose bounty all our excellences flow. This is the way it was for a million years before July 20th, 1969.
College to Jet.
We and the land have lived together for almost 400 years, and there will always be a part of it we will never conquer. The biblical injunction, be fruitful and multiply and subdue the earth, carried us through the 19th century. We farmed the Midwest, and the wheat fields of the Plain States were what we thought was meant by subdue the land. Ocean of plenty that would last us forever, so said the 19th century.
This is a giant drill or auger being driven directly back into the coal face. Some of these instruments are as much as 72 inches in diameter and can fill a 35-ton truck to capacity in 22 seconds.
The speaker is Harry Caudill, direct descendant of the people who settled these eastern Kentucky hills. The process he is describing is called strip mining. The issue is power, not only the electric power derived from coal, but the power of human intelligence to corrupt the physical world. By sheer use of intelligence, we had arrived at pollution. With his Kentucky drawl and his journalist's eye for detail, Harry Caudill talked about the death of the mountains he lives in.
These trucks carry the coal to the nearest railhead, where it is loaded into cars, and most of it is eventually used in the generation of electricity. A still more destructive form of strip mining has come into the mountains, and this consists of simply taking a mountain apart layer by layer. The first seam of coal is taken out. Then the process is repeated until the second seam is reached. And this may go on until three or four seams of coal have been recovered. The industries and the men who murder mountains are generally quite understandably ashamed of their work. So most operators won't permit people to visit their mining sites. They patrol the sites with trucks equipped with radios and occupied by men armed with cast-off U.S. Army rifles, and people are just simply not permitted on the mining site. Frequently, it is necessary, if these mountains are to be seen at all, and if the nature of their death is to be understood at all, it is necessary to see them from the air. Most of this stripping actually is being done to recover only the outcrop that's left on the mountainside after deep mining has gotten practically all the coal. This is an act in most areas of supreme greed, because the mountain, having yielded about 95% of its coal, are now torn apart to get out that remaining tiny little band right around the edge. This seam of coal that you're seeing mined there is so sulfur-laden that in the old days, when men had to mine with livestock, horses, mules, and that kind of thing, they couldn't mine that coal because it ate the feet off these ponies. Sometimes they put rubber boots on them, but if they got holes in there, it would eat their feet off. Sulfuric acid. But now they take this out with these machines, send it into these cities, turn it into electricity, dump the sulfur in the air, and let the people breathe it. Sulfuric water for the people who drink, sulfuric acid for those who breathe, and profits for the coal companies. That's a great arrangement. About 40% of the coal coming out of these hills is bought by the Tennessee Valley Authority. Consequently, it must be kept in mind that the Tennessee Valley Authority and the government of the United States are full-scale working partners in the destruction of these mountains.
In 1969, we needed some 20 billion prime horsepower to move America. We consumed 1.5 trillion kilowatt hours of electricity. Our power was costing us mountains, rivers, and cities, and we weren't going to give it up. For the fact is that America lives by its complicated, interwoven technology. A few people can be potters and cowboys. The rest of us move to a different and sometimes beautiful rhythm. The music is no longer Grieg. the time is no longer the 19th century, but not quite yet the 21st.
I think they have a mantuan. I'll put an end to all their courtship. I'll send him silent to his grave.
Whose time was it? Who did July 20th, 1969 really belong to? At the Newport Folk Festival, when the Master of Ceremonies tried to announce we had landed on the moon, the young ones knew, but they didn't want to hear.
You might be interested to know that can't make it.
Hey, they just landed on the moon, you know? They're all there. Did you know that?
We made the moon.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
We learned a lesson from the butterfly's wings about perfect fit in a bra. They inspired the patented stretch wing front of every Playtex Living bra. Each elastic wing stretches separately so cups fit snugly no matter how you move. And even after 50 machine washings, these stretch panels will keep stretching with you. For perfect fit you can't wash out, Playtex Living Bra.
Get a taste of whiteness, taste it with McLean's.
Wow.
Come to life with whiteness, get a smile that's seen.
You can taste whiteness happen with McLean's. Whiteness that brings you to people, brings you to life.
Get a taste of life.
F-R-E-E, free from Reynolds Wrap. This 49-cent value, the Reynolds Wrap Freezer Marker Pen by Scripto. Non-toxic, permanent, and no smear, see? Now you can label everything you put in your freezer with date, contents, and weight. Get your Freezer Marker Pen, a 49-cent value, free, right inside specially marked packages of heavy-duty Reynolds Wrap.
Just a little sheet of Reynolds Wrap can freeze food better, protect better, wrap better, and cover better. You can even cook in it. Just a little sheet of Reynolds Wrap, strong, tear-resistant Reynolds Wrap, can do more for a woman than any other wrap. Because Reynolds Wrap is oven-tempered for flexible strength. Reynolds Wrap. Wouldn't you hate to be without it?
Eagle now is in a orbit measuring 9.4 nautical miles at insertion or perilune and 46.7 at apolune.
The high point of America's belief in the machine may have happened on July 20th, 1969. A quarter of a million miles high over the world, two pieces of American equipment floated away from each other. Eagle and Columbia were the pinnacle of 1970 technology. Billions of dollars, billions of man hours floating towards the moon.
I think you got a fine looking flying machine there, Eagle, despite the fact you're upside down.
Somebody's upside down.
Offutt Air Force Base, Omaha. The time is Midwest noon. This is a B-36, a mastodon of the post-war era, half jet, half propeller, all extinct. Like 99% of the trillions we had spent on military hardware after World War II, the B-36 had never been used in anger. We were spending a tithe, a tenth of our national income, on military matters. There was a feeling growing in the land that we should be able to keep the peace another way, at less cost and with fewer weapons. But the Strategic Air Command said this: if peace had been kept with the Russians, SAC had made the peace. 24 hours a day for almost 25 years, SAC headquarters had watched the world. But the world had aged. Not only the bombers had grown old in the Cold War. The buttons had never been pushed except in practice. This technology had served its purpose. The shape of the world had changed, and so the rules had changed. Like when they reshaped the football for passing, nobody could drop kick anymore.
Skybird, this is drop kick with a maintenance test of all stations. There will be no authentication with this maintenance test. Acknowledge now. Drop kick out.
That's the tale of an abandoned guided missile. That's an empty propane gas container. And this is a commune in Taos, New Mexico, that's looking for a new technology. This may be the most or least American sequence we filmed all day. The domed building was erected by the members of the commune, most of whom have tried drugs and given them up, tried the civil rights movement and given it up, tried Judeo-Christianity and given it up for the religions of the East. They eat no meat, and except for personal clothing and toilet articles, they own nothing as individuals. Except for variations in the diet, this experiment is as old as America. The last great surge of communal living took place in the 19th century, but it died out in a few years. They have given up drugs. They have given up profit and loss statements. They have given up pride in the gross national product. They have given up war and war-related economics. In the underground of the youth movement, this is where the action was on July 20th, 1969. Tobacco and liquor are prohibited here. What is welcomed in the Far West is the Far East, Zen and Buddha in New Mexico. Zen, Buddha, and the adobe of the American Indian. Adobe is a mixture of straw and mud. It makes walls that are cool in summer and warm in winter. Winter was on everyone's mind this July 20th. The survival of the commune depended on shelter being ready for the cold weather. The real estate dealers around Taos have said that about $500,000 has been spent for communal lands in the region. Obviously, there's a financial connection back to the middle class this group rejects.
You got the idea now?
Yeah.
Okay.
It goes a lot faster.
One of the women each day takes care of everybody's children. Family life, for those who are married, is respected. When we asked one of the women, what's it all for? Why do you give up material things? She answered, to get back to basic things.
Wow. Wow.
Wow. Here, Nicole, you hold one?
Yeah, I see another egg, I think I see another egg.
We'll get it.
There's a chicken there, though.
You can reach out to the chicken.
It's standing up going down.
Thank you.
July 1969 was three summers from black, two summers from pot, one summer in advance of ecology. Communes were an idea whose year was to come. We were asked not to say exactly where we filmed because they didn't want transient college kids looking for a summer vacation. The leader of the commune spoke to us.
It's important for people to understand is that these things are not started and lived in by freaks and communists and people like that. But what I'm interested in is in really living out what we started out to do when we signed that Declaration of Independence right back there in the beginning. We the people, in order to form a more perfect union, and that's the whole message. And we've been fighting and wrangling about it, north versus south, east versus west, for all these years, and we've got to start someplace. And over again, I keep coming back to it. This is not a world-shattering event. It's nothing. It's just a group of people who've decided to try and live out all those things that our forefathers believed in, very simply.
The work against winter proceeded all day long, a dome atop adobe walls.
This is Apollo Control at 102 hours, 12 minutes into the flight of Apollo 11. 21 minutes, 23 seconds from the beginning of the powered descent to the lunar surface.
Then, in mid-afternoon, a certain ineptness took place in ripsaw technology.
Okay, so that's it, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it.
Maybe this isn't plugged in.
Yeah, you're on the floor.
When they discovered the machine was not plugged in, they got nervous about everything else. The question soon became, as you'll see, is the blade turning in the right direction?
Is that the right...
Yeah, it's right.
To go in. What?
Is the blade on backwards?
No, it has to. There's an arrow here which shows direction of rotation.
Right.
It says do not. And so we should be going in from this side. It says do not.
By mid-afternoon, it began to look as if it would be a cold, cold winter.
Okay, because when it was coasting.
Ripsaw trouble is at what might be called the inner limits of American technology.
Columbia, Houston, over.
Houston, Columbia.
At the outer limits of our skills, we could throw Apollo 11 to the moon and build beautiful glass palaces. But on July 20th, the great American dilemma was that we had skills beyond our ability to use them. For technically, if we knew how to build glass palaces, there was no reason to live in hovels. A city is a machine, and the city machines, like the one called New York, were breaking down. Not only the devices that made living easier, but the very skills that kept us alive were sometimes not available for use.
10 a day, 4 times a day, 5 times a day, what?
3.
If you live in the machine called New York, and you're poor, and you get sick, you go to the local hospital and hope you'll be lucky. On July 20th, there was a minor epidemic of viral infections on the Upper West Side. Columbia Presbyterian was short 200 nurses. The nurse in charge this day was Miss Toby Miche.
A young girl has been brought in by the police. The complaint is that she has a very high fever. She is conscious, and she's very frightened. Her mother is also very frightened. So rather than carry her in the blanket, which increases a fever, I had stopped and taken the blanket off, and I'm just walking her into a room where I can then take her temperature and find out just how high her fever is. I'm rubbing her because she is hot. She's very hot. Get her cooled off a little bit, but just getting the air to her will do some good.
Miss, on Georgia Carter, I forgot to tell you that she has Medicare and Medicaid.
Nurse Miche went back to her desk because it looked like a simple case. Then it became complicated.
I turned around, and I'm going for the room. I'm going quickly. I've gotten into the room. The little girl is having a seizure. A seizure is a convulsion. If a convulsion continues for a long time, then brain damage may occur. Now I'm drawing up the first seizure medication that he might want. The medicine is Valium. We're trying to put in an intravenous, trying to put a needle into her vein so that we can give her the Valium directly into the vein. When the child started her seizure, or when we first saw the child seizing, we put a padded tongue blade in her mouth so that she would not bite her tongue, so that we could prevent her from biting her tongue.
A few moments later, Nurse Miche noted,
she isn't stopping the seizure, and we've given her 5 milligrams of Valium, so we probably will give her more.
Dr. Klein,
you put it in 10 cc.
Yep. Dr. Klein, you wanted him?
Yeah.
Was he in the building?
Klein is the pediatrician.
Yeah.
But was he in the building? Yes.
Now they were coming into a tight corner. 4-year-old Anna Arias was convulsing. To stop the convulsion, she was given strong depressants. The danger was that the medicines would not only stop the convulsions, they would stop vital functions like breathing and heartbeat.
Okay, I'll take that lady up to the labor room now.
Why don't somebody help hold this?
Okay, I'll get it.
Get the woman up to the labor room before she has another baby.
Okay, because I hate to deliver it.
If a convulsion continues for a long time, then brain damage may occur. Half of a nurse's job is anticipating what a doctor will want. And I am trying to anticipate what he might need and will need so that he doesn't have to stop and ask me for it.
A children's surgeon had now arrived in the room. A neurologist had been asked for. The medical forces of the hospital were mobilizing. But something happened to Anna's breathing, and the nurse was first to hear.
I've decided to suction her because she sounds wet, which means she definitely has some fluid in her mouth, and I don't want it to get down into her lungs. By suctioning her, I can just take the fluid out of her mouth, out of around her mouth, and prevent that from happening.
What's her name?
Anna.
Anna?
And then her last name is Barry.
Anna?
Marita. 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 Arias is the other one. Anna? Anna?
We've given Anna 3 doses of intravenous medication, which most times would stop convulsions. This time it hasn't. Her breathing has slowed down quite a bit. She has not stopped breathing, but there is always the chance she may stop breathing. And just for safety's sake, we've decided to move from the room we're in into another room, which we call an arrest room. It's a room with any and all equipment that we might need directly at our hands. So right now we're moving.
Apollo 11, Apollo 11. Good morning from the block team. Good morning. We've got about 2 minutes to LOS here, Mike.
Good morning, you guys wake up early.
Yeah, you're about 2 minutes earlier on the wake up. Looks like you're really.
Is neuro on stat for us?
Yes.
That's right. Put P0 on stat, too, then.
Status report. Anna Arias at the same moment. What was feared was that the drugs would stop Anna's breathing and possibly her heart. She had been taken to a cardiac arrest room. She was still convulsing. The convulsions have thrown the needles out of her body. What must now be done by the pediatric surgeon is a cut into the leg, directly into the vein, so the medication can be put into her bicatheter tube. On the left, the pediatric surgeon is preparing to operate.
Very frequently, someone is counting how many times she's breathing per minute. This has been going on since the first time we gave her medication, and especially since the second time, because we just don't want her to slow down her breathing and then stop.
Do I have some xylocaine?
1%
plain.
1% plain across. No, it has to be shown.
You have to give a needle. Four needles in here.
She's had an awful lot of medicine, and we're giving her more. She's still seizing.
You have the intercap?
We're trying.
Do you have a small needle?
All the hands are one person trying to do a cut down to get into her. One person trying to hold her. I'm reaching across trying to suction her and to hold her at the same time. Another person's reached across to hold her so that I can just help with the IV. Everyone is trying all at once to do something.
But don't you make it too tight, isn't it?
It's not that tight.
This part is.
There are 12 hands on Anna Arias' body. 12 hands dependent on each other, dependent on complicated skills, complicated machinery. And each of us, healthy and alive on July 20th, would like it like this when we become ill.
Do you have four self-farmers?
I put it in here. What happened to it?
There are 12 hands on Anna Arias' body, and at a given moment, the hands know the convulsions have stopped.
She's definitely alive. What he's looking to see is the level of consciousness. Crying is the best sound in the world to hear when you have heard nothing from a child before that. Anna is past crisis now.
From sunup to sundown, you can get from Maine to Hawaii with a lot of daylight left over. I landed in Oahu and changed planes for Kauai, westernmost of the Hawaiian Islands. The northwestern edge of Kauai is so rugged that a road has never been built through these cliffs. Meanwhile, a more important trip was about to end. It is about 44 minutes before man is due to land on the moon. And now, some 75 million Americans were gathered at their television sets. July 20th, 1969 was a day when we were both pushed by fear and led by hope. It was not the hardware a quarter of a million miles away. It was not the lives of three astronauts most of us had never met. It was that somehow, 44 minutes before man first landed on the moon, everything American, every good thing, every bad thing, had gotten fused into the very metal of Apollo 11. There we are, up there, 203 million of us, 193 years of the United States, crammed, bad and good, into July 20th, 1969.
Come on.
Please bear in mind, gentlemen, the only way old Uncle Sam can repay you for your personal property which has been lost is for you to submit a claim to the government for reimbursement. Are there any questions on this, gentlemen?
Roger, we copy. At the Earth, right out our front window. Houston, you're looking at our Delta H. That's affirmative. Program alarm. Looking good to us, over. 1202. Good radar data. Altitude now 33,500 feet. Give us a reading on the 1202 program alarm.
So now that the two of you have found each other and are come together, perhaps we can be at the very end of having just two halves.
Whose idea was it to come down here?
Well, somebody else's, not mine.
And I said that I couldn't watch Steve play because he's over at the baccarat tables and he's playing with $100 bills. So he said, here, honey, here's some nickels. Go have fun.
7 minutes, 30 seconds into the burn. Altitude 16,300 feet. Eagle, Houston, it's descent to fuel to monitor, over.
1-2.
Altitude 13,005. Velocity 9,100 feet per second.
Made it, switch over time, please, just.
Roger, stand by. You're looking great at 8 minutes. Yeah, correction on that velocity, now reading 760 feet per second. It's the P-64.
I spent 5 years in a Yugoslavian jail because I would not bear arms, because Jesus said, love thy neighbor as thyself.
Hey, we talk languages here. Hey, todo barato. Bueno barato. Hey, tzatzke de mamas, we got it here for you. Hey, I got it on sale here. Hey, step in here, let's look them over here. Hey, help me keep my wife in the country.
Roger, understand. Go for landing. 3,000 feet. Shock alarm. We're go. Same time. We're go. And a half. Six forward. 60 seconds. Lights on. Down 2.5. Forward. Forward. 40 feet down, 2.5. Picking up some dust. 30 feet, 2.5 down. Straight shadow. 4 forward. 4 forward. Drift into the right a little. 20. Down 1.5. 30 seconds. Forward. Just. Good. Contact light. Okay, engine stop. ATA at a descent.
Houston, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue.
Host control, both auto descent engine command override off. Engine arm off. 413 is in. Houston,
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue.
Man on the moon.
We copy you down, Eagle.
Listen,
Tranquility
Base here. The Eagle has landed.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're bringing you to
What?
We're going to be busy for a minute.
Contact light. Okay, engine stop. APA at a descent. Both control, both autos. Engine command override off. Engine on board. 413 is in.
Man on the moon.
We copy you down, Eagle. Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed. Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breaking again. Thanks a lot.
A few hours after touchdown on the moon, the sun set on the east coast of the United States. And then, equally, impartially, daylight receded from the tidewater lands of Virginia, from the small towns in Ohio and Mississippi, from the big cities of the Midwest and the Far West, the Big Sky Country, the Mountain States, the Pacific Coast. A day in the life of the United States gives one sunrise and one sunset to everyone. An astronomical event had happened. This is the last light falling on the United States. Those are the Nepali Cliffs on the island of Kauai, westernmost of the Hawaiian Islands. America ends here. This beach is unreachable by road or by foot. We came in by helicopter to see the finish of this day. Neil Armstrong and Edwin Aldrin, right now, are standing on the moon. The rest of us will always remember where we were at this moment. Beyond that sunset is the international dateline, where it's already tomorrow. July 20th, 1969 is over. And what did it mean, our landing on the moon? Perhaps like the Egyptians and their pyramids, like the Greeks and their Parthenon, the engineering that took us to the moon was the apex of our American civilization. Perhaps we advance from here or recede from here. But on July 20th, 1969, the Americans put a mark on the sky. This is Charles Kuralt. Good night. Watching a test of a totally new flash system. Now, Kodak announces Instamatic X cameras that take flash pictures without flash batteries. The surest flash system yet. With a Kodak Instamatic X camera and a Magic Cube Type X, there are no flash batteries to wear out, no flash batteries to replace, ever. Kodak Instamatic X cameras are always ready. Time after time. Month after month. Year after year. You get four full-powered flashes with each Magic Cube. And then the Kodak Instamatic X camera tells you to change cubes. There are several models of the Kodak Instamatic X camera at a wide range of prices, some in complete outfits. See the flash cameras that work without flash batteries. The new Kodak Instamatic X cameras, starting at less than $21 at your Kodak dealers.